This A-level IB biology video is all about semi-conservative replication and the evidence for it. So in a previous video, I told you that DNA is copied in a semi-conservative way. And what that means is that the new DNA molecule contains one new strand of DNA and one old strand. So that old strand came from the original DNA being copied. But how did scientists know that? Well, let's think about how science actually works, because lots of things we're taught of as being fact. But how do we decide upon these new facts? When does something become a fact as opposed to a theory? Well, in order to prove something, you need scientific evidence. And in order to provide evidence, you need theories. So a theory is something that you think is true, and evidence proves it one way or another. Now, the scientists that were important with working out the structure of DNA were James Watson and Francis Crick. And they used Rosalind Franklin's X-ray diffraction studies in order to study the structure of DNA. Now, the two hypotheses for the replication of DNA were, number one, the conservative model, and number two, the semi-conservative model, which we know to be correct, but we need to discuss both now. So, the conservative model suggested that the original DNA molecule remained intact and that a separate daughter DNA copy was built up from new nucleotides. So we're just going to summarise that here. So the daughter DNA copy was built up from new nucleotides using the original DNA as a template, effectively. So what does the semi-conservative model state? Well, in this model, we're proposing that the original DNA molecule splits into two separate strands, each of which is replicated, and then the two daughter molecules formed contain one new strand and one old strand. So what does that mean? Well, it means that each of the two new molecules formed contains one strand of new material and one strand of old material. But how could we prove which of these models is correct? Well, it's a fairly straightforward process. As long as you can label the original DNA in some way, and then effectively take a picture of it and have a look at what the new DNA contains. So Meselson and Stahl were two scientists that designed the experiment, and they based their experiment on several facts. Firstly, that DNA contains a nitrogenous base, so that means that DNA contains nitrogen. We're going to dip into chemistry and physics now. Now, nitrogen, we know it's an element. There are two isotopes of nitrogen you need to be aware of, one of which is radioactive. So remember that an isotope is an atom of the same element, so obviously nitrogen, with the same number of protons but a different number of neutrons. So what that means for nitrogen is these two isotopes are nitrogen 14, which is your regular isotope, and the heavier nitrogen 15, which contains one more neutron. Notice that they both contain seven protons, hence why they're the same element. So obviously this nitrogen over here will be heavier. The next thing they used to help them with their experiment was the fact that they could use bacteria in order to produce the new DNA. So if the bacteria are provided with nitrogen, they will incorporate either nitrogen 14 or nitrogen 15. So their next chain of reasoning was that if they grew the bacteria on a medium containing only 14 nitrogen, their DNA would obviously be lighter than any bacteria grown on a medium containing 15 nitrogen. And then from a simplistic point of view, if you could measure the mass of the new DNA, that would tell you what type of replication had taken place. So we'll write that overview down here. So bacteria grown on a nutrient medium containing 14 nitrogen would have DNA which was lighter than bacteria grown in a medium with 15 nitrogen. In the second step, the scientists transferred the heavy bacteria to a medium with 14 nitrogen for one replication only. Obviously, they need a way of separating out the different DNA types, and so they spin it, which is known as using a centrifuge. And when you spin it, the lighter DNA collects at the top of the tube, and the heavier DNA collects at the bottom of the tube. They repeated the experiment, but in the following experiments, they examined the DNA after 2 and then 3 generations, and then by interpreting the results, they could work out which hypothesis was correct. And we'll have a look now at the results. We're now going to look in great detail at the experiment itself. So let's start with this first DNA strand. And as you can see, both DNA strands contain the heavy nitrogen, the 15 nitrogen. So let's label it as the original heavy strand of DNA. We're going to centrifuge it though. So we're going to spin it, and we'll notice that all the DNA will sit towards the bottom of the tube because it's heavy. So here's your tube, and here's where the DNA sits towards the bottom because it's heavy. We're now going to take that heavy original DNA and pop it in a medium containing only lighter 14 nitrogen. Now, because of semi-conservative replication, what's going to happen is that original strand will split and the new daughter strands will contain one of the old strands, the heavy strands, and one of the new strands, the lighter strands, and I'll show you that now. So here's our original DNA again. It's going to split and the daughter strands will each contain one of the old strands. And then because it's grown in a medium containing the lighter nitrogen, it will contain one of the light strands. So let's write a summary of that. After the first replication, new DNA contains both the 14 nitrogen and the 15 nitrogen. And if we actually look, once we've centrifuged this DNA, because they're all the same, they're all identical, they'll all sit at the same level, but they'll sit slightly higher because they're going to be lighter than that original centrifuging, which only had the heavy DNA in. What happens if we wanted to replicate this first generation then? So we wanted to produce new DNA. So we'll start with what now is the parent DNA. And I'm going to draw that again. And when we replicate it, this first 15N strand of DNA will go off into the new DNA molecule. this 14n, we'll go into another one, and so on and so forth. So let's draw that now. And when we carry out these experiments, the new medium that we place the DNA in is always the lighter nitrogen, so 14N. So those unpaired nucleotides will pair up now with the exposed DNA bases. So actually what you'll find is this second strand belonging to this DNA molecule will be 14N. Same here. And so on and so forth. And we'll write a summary as to what we're actually showing here. So after the second replication, there are four molecules of DNA. Two molecules contain 14N and 15N. Two molecules contain two lots of 14N. So they contain 14N only. And you can see that here. So the two molecules containing 14N and 15N are these two here. And the two molecules containing 14N only are these two here. Now we need to centrifuge those second generation results and see what we get in terms of bands. And so once you've centrifuged, you'll get two bands of DNA. The highest band is the lightest DNA. That containing 14N only. The lowest band contains DNA with both 14N and 15N nitrogen, and therefore is at the intermediate level. Remember, if we scroll up, the original DNA contained only 15N nitrogen, which is why it sits at the lowest point. And just notice that it's the presence of these bands at different heights within the tube that proves that DNA is replicated in a semi-conservative manner.